Welcome back to another edition of the 12 Kyle podcast. I am your boy 12 Kyle, and we're back with another Mount Rushmore edition of the podcast. Yeah, this one's going to be I'm not going to say it's going to be easy, but this one hits close to home. On this episode, we're going to talk about Mount Rushmore for the city of Atlanta. As many of you know or may not know, I live in Atlanta, been living here since 1997. So this is home. This is my adopted home. Been here long enough to have seen a lot. And so in saying that, when I initially got the idea to do the Mount Rushmore on Atlanta, I was like, oh, yeah, it'll be pretty easy. Yeah and no. I mean, there's some athletes in Atlanta that are very, very highly revered. And then there are some that are, you know, not so much revered. So I don't know that I'm necessarily going to surprise you with who will be on my Mount Rushmore. But again, this is my Mount Rushmore. For those of you new to the Mount Rushmore series, you pick four people. And in this case, we're talking about athletes and athletes that have played in a particular city, and they go on the proverbial Mount Rushmore for that particular city. So without further ado, in no particular order, here are my Mount Rushmore for the city of Atlanta. Number one, Dominique Wilkins from the Atlanta Hawks. I will go out on a limb and say anybody and everybody that does a Mount Rushmore for Atlanta, you got to have Dominique on there. Drafted by the Atlanta Hawks. He was infamously traded later on in his career, but Dominique definitely put on for the city. Dominique represented Atlanta, really, if you think about it. He represented Atlanta in a time where it wasn't necessarily cool to say that you were from Atlanta or in Atlanta. And the Hawks, I mean, you guys know, the Hawks never won an NBA title. I think the closest they got in Dominique's era to an NBA title was... I want to say, did they get to the Eastern Conference? I don't even know if they got to the Eastern Conference Finals. I know they ran into Boston a couple of times. And I mean, we're talking about the Boston Celtics from the 80s. You know what I'm saying? With Larry Bird, Kevin McHale, and Robert Parrish. Those championship Celtics teams. So they never could really get over the hump. But nonetheless, Dominique bought flair and glare. He was the ultimate sportsman. Good dude, really. Slam dunk champion, perennial all-star. So Dominique definitely goes on my Mount Rushmore. Number two on the Mount Rushmore, a guy who actually can claim two teams in this city. That would be Deion Sanders, aka Primetime. Before he was Coach Prime, he was prime time in this city. Deion played both for the Atlanta Falcons and the Atlanta Braves, who are now the Cobb County Braves, but that's another story for a whole another podcast. Yeah, man, Prime was Deion was the ultimate Falcon. I mean, like Deion, and to be honest, Deion Sanders played on some raggedy Falcons teams, but he was must see. And I want to say the first time Deion got in the game, I want to say it was on a punt return in Fulton County Stadium. This is before they even built the Georgia Dome. Fulton County Stadium, he took it back to the house, and the star was born, man, Deion Sanders. Yeah, Prime was something special in this city, man, and people loved and still love him to this day. And you can go anywhere in Atlanta, you see that number 21 jersey with Sanders on the back. I mean, he put Atlanta on the map. A lot of people wish, and Deion said this himself, he was like, you know, he is forever grateful to the Falcons for giving him the opportunity to play football. He was like, but if he could have done it all over again, he would have retired as an Atlanta Falcon. and stayed here his whole career. I think that would have been dope. But I mean, if we're being honest, if Deion stays here his entire career, he's not going to win the two Super Bowl rings that he won with the 49ers and the Dallas Cowboys. So very, very loved and beloved and huge figure here in the city of Atlanta, prime time. Before he was Coach Prime, he was Deion Sanders prime time. And, he's the only man to have played in a Super Bowl and a World Series. And he was a pretty good player for the Atlanta Braves. And I'll be honest, man, and I think it goes without saying, but I mean, if Deion could have dedicated himself and not having to have split time between baseball and football, first of all, it's damn near impossible to play professional football and professional baseball. But I think he was very good in the outfield, a decent hitter. But I think if he had played and been able to, establish himself on a baseball field with more time, I think he would have been a perennial all-star in baseball too. But you can't play both and play at the high levels because the seasons overlap. So, he was only going to be able to play baseball, but for so long before he had to go back to football and vice versa. So, number two, definitely prime time. Number three may come as a surprise to you, but if you're from Atlanta or you've lived in the city, you know exactly what this guy's meant to the city. Number three, boxing. That's right. The real deal, Evander Holyfield, comes in at number three on my Mount Rushmore. Holyfield, man, was a beast. Born and raised here. Definitely put on for the city. Always represented the city in the right way. He had this huge mansion that you could actually see from the street. I think his house was bought by Rick Ross. Rick Ross currently owns the house now. But Holyfield was a great guy. In and outside of the ring, did a lot of community service and still does a lot of community work in and around the city. He was somebody who always represented, and he's one of the greatest boxers to ever step inside the square circle. I could make a case that he hung on too long as far as boxing is concerned, but that's beside the point, man. Evander Holyfield is definitely on my Mount Rushmore. Number four, last but not least, for the Atlanta Falcons, number seven, Michael Vick. Now, I know some of you probably watching this and listening to this thinking, well, how is Matt Ryan not on there? How is this person not on there? It is very hard to describe the Michael Vick experience for those who weren't around for it. Michael Vick, in his prime, was must-see TV. One of the reasons why Michael Vick was such a popular NFL player and dope NFL player, one, he was fast as all. I mean, the guy ran like a 4.2. But here's the thing. In football, it's rare for the best player on the field to touch the ball every single play. That rarely happens. I mean, if you got a great running back, he's not getting the ball every play. If you got a great receiver, he's not getting the ball every play. If you got a dope cornerback, he's not touching the ball every play. But in Atlanta, in Michael Vick's prime, he was the best player, not only on the offense, but he was the best player on the field. And he touched the ball every single play. So there were plays where Michael Vick, I mean, like the roar of the crowd or the anticipation of what he might do, it was just electric. I can remember going to Falcons games and like games kicked off at 1 o'clock, right? And the game, before the game would even start, like people would be down at the Georgia Dome tailgating literally at 7 o'clock in the morning. And I mean, like, they're eating breakfast, eating lunch, whatever the case may be. People drinking the whole night, getting high, whatever, whatever. At 12 o'clock, no later than 12:15, you'd better start making your way inside the dome. And the reason being is because you had to be in your seat. You just had to be in your seat when the game, well, actually, even before the game started. When Michael Vick played and they would do the introductions for the offense, man, listen, all you would hear is, woo, bring them out, bring them out, bring them out. It's hard to yell when the barrel's in your mouth, from Jay-Z. And the crowd would go crazy. People would be waving towels. Michael Vick would come out there. They would call his name. He would get the biggest standing ovation. And the Georgia Dome literally would be shaking. Now, Michael Vick wasn't as even as great as he was in his era, in his prime. That's not what he's going to be remembered for by some. He will always be remembered for the dog fight, his participation in the dog fighting ring that he got caught up in, that he financed and led, and he spent 2 years in jail for. And honestly, Michael Vick's going to jail, or Michael Vick being involved in dog fighting altogether in this city, literally split the city in half. And it was literally drawing down racial lines, black and white. If you ask a black person about Michael Vick, you know, you might get an answer like, oh man, it was just some damn dogs, who cares? And then if you ask some white people, they'd be like, oh man, I can't believe he did that. How could you be so cruel to animals? And I get it, I get both sides of it, because for some black people, they don't understand how you could do 2 years for killing a dog, but you could shoot somebody on the street and not do any time. And for some white people, you know, they would hear these horrific things about what Michael Vick and his friends did to those dogs. And then as they're watching this on TV, little Sparky comes in the room. So I get it. And it was a lightning rod, particularly on sports talk radio, because everybody had a side. Everybody had an opinion. And sports talk radio really would just, it would blow up. I mean, like, if you ever wanted to, if there was nothing else to talk about, if there was nothing going on, oh, let's open up the phone lines and talk about the Michael Vick accusations, or what do you thought about Michael Vick's era in the city? Listen, even though the Atlanta Falcons are known for blowing a 25-point lead in the Super Bowl, a lot of people still associate the Atlanta Falcons with Michael Vick and his time here. And the bad was bad. I mean, like, I said at the time, I was like, look, if he's convicted of what they said, if he did what they said he said that he did, then he should suffer the consequences. And he did. The flip side of it was when Michael Vick got out of jail and got signed by Philadelphia, and he went and performed in Philadelphia. That was the quarterback that we needed here in Atlanta, because Michael Vick, for as great and highlight reel as he wasn't as focused as a player and as a man and as a football player and as a teammate and as a leader, but he was when he got to Philadelphia. If Atlanta had gotten the Michael Vick that was in Philadelphia instead of the Michael Vick that we had that was here, man, listen, Vick might have 2 or 3 rings by now. And it's the ultimate what if. But I still think that time, if you separate, because in my opinion, I think you have to separate what someone does off the field for the Rushmore. At least for me. Your Rushmore, you might be like, oh, there's no way I'm putting Michael Vick on a Mount Rushmore. That's me. This is my Mount Rushmore, 12 Kyle. And if you disagree, cool. That's cool too. But you weren't here, so, you know, if you weren't in the city, you wouldn't understand. And I'm just scratching the surface as to how things were. It was incredible that time Michael Vick was here. And so I got to put him on the Mount Rushmore. So there you have it. Dominique Wilkins, primetime, Deion Sanders, Evander Holyfield, and Michael Vick. That's my Mount Rushmore. And that's going to do it for me. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for checking out this edition of the 12 Kyle podcast. I am your boy, 12 Kyle. I'll catch you guys next time. 5 G's.